Without further ado, it is my pleasure to welcome and call to the stage Marianne Tocci, that is going to introduce the first keynote speaker.
All right, good morning, everyone. We're so honored today to welcome Dr. Philomena Bloisen, a professor of indoor environment in the Department of Architectural Engineering and Technology at Delft University in the Netherlands. Dr. Bloisen received her engineering degree in 1986 at the Technical University of Eindhoven and received her PhD in 1990 at the Technical University of Denmark. After working for more than 20 years as a researcher with TNO, where she coordinated, among other things, several European projects on the optimization of indoor environmental quality and energy use, she was appointed as full professor indoor environment in 2012 at the Faculty of Architecture and the Built Environment at the Delft University of Technology. At the TU Delft, she's initiated the Sense Lab, a semi-lab environment partly open to the public and sponsored by over 25 companies and organizations. Professor Bloisen is a member of many organizations, including TVBL, REVA, ASHRAE, ICIAC, and CIB. She's also co-founder of the Dutch ICIAC chapter and was its first president. She's also contributed to or authored more than 220 publications. For her indoor environment handbook, How to Make Buildings Healthy and Comfortable, she received the prestigious Choice Outstanding Academic Titles of 2010 award. And her book, The Healthy Indoor Environment, How to Assess Occupant Well-Being in Buildings, was published in 2014 and has received the IDEC 2016 Book Award. So we're so delighted to welcome her to present her paper, which includes the thoughts for the need for an integrated approach to assessing indoor environmental quality. So please give a warm welcome to Dr. Bloisen.
Thank you for this nice introduction, and I'm very happy to be here and to be invited to call over to Barry, which is my first time actually in Barry, but it's a lovely city. Now, talking about indoor environment. Indoor environment, actually we spend about 80 to 90% of our time indoors. And that's why indoor environment is so important to us. And we spend it at home, at school, and at the office. It's actually much more important than outdoor environment in terms of exposure. What most people are not aware of, that this staying indoors causes a lot of diseases and disorders. As we see in the last decades or so, we see an increase in the amount of mental disorders. We see an increase in obesity. We see an increase in diseases that take longer to manifest, such as cardiovascular diseases, lung cancer, etc., but also chronic respiratory diseases. Think of asthma with children or COPD. So it seems that staying in that indoor environment is not so good for our health, even though we keep to the standards that we have defined for that indoor environmental quality. Now, what is indoor environmental quality, in my lecture at least? I see indoor environmental quality as the collection of lighting quality, acoustical quality, air quality, and thermal quality. And although important, aesthetic quality and spatial and economic quality are not part of this definition. I need to tell this always to my students in Delft, because they are architectural students and they are actually very much focused on aesthetic quality and spatial quality. Now let's start with the first one, thermal quality. Thermal quality is probably the factor that we are most aware of. Who doesn't talk about the weather? At least in the Netherlands, it is really the topic of today. Will it be warm? Will it be cold? Will it be drafty? Are we going to expect rain? Do we need an umbrella? All parts of thermal quality. Now, already in the 1970s, Professor Fanger tested his thermal visualological model that we still use today in our standards, actually, with live subjects in thermal chambers, as you can see here. Now, what is thermal quality? What is thermal balance? Thermal balance is controlled in our brain, and it's based on our body temperature. It comprises of the core temperature, which lies around 37 degrees with a healthy subject, and the skin temperature, which is normally around 34 degrees Celsius. Now, when we get too warm, a message goes from the hypothalamus to our nervous system to tell the vessels to close down, to open, so we lose more heat, and we even start sweating. Now, on the other side, if we're getting too cold, the vessels will close, and we start shivering to increase our energy level to get a higher temperature. When people are dissatisfied about their thermal environment, they can get into thermal stress. Now, thermal stress occurs when people feel they are not able to control their thermal comfort, or they believe or perceive it isn't possible. Now, already some time ago, a new model was introduced next to the model of Professor Fanger, also based on reaching a neutral temperature, called the adaptive comfort model, where expectations and perceived level of control are taken into account, which is not in the model of Fanger. Now, what is interesting to know is that perhaps this keeping these neutral conditions is not that healthy at all. Even though we think it's comfortable, it could have health effects. Some research shows that these thermal neutral conditions could in fact lead to an increased adiposity, an increased number of fat cells. There was some studies performed first with rats and then with male adults. They were divided into groups. One group was exposed to neutral conditions for a certain time, neutral thermal conditions, and the other group was exposed to extreme changing conditions. Now, at the end, they measured the fat tissue, and they saw that the group that was exposed to thermal neutral conditions for a longer time had an increased amount of fat tissue, which is, in fact, not so strange, because they don't spend that energy they are consuming. But it could give us an indication that perhaps this strive for always to be in a neutral conditions, even when we sleep at night, having this temperature at 23 degrees Celsius is not so good for our health, as it is not so good for our energy use as well. Lighting quality. Lighting quality, that is the factor that our architecture students interest the most. And we talk about brightness, we talk about colors, we can see the things around, we talk about illuminance. But we also talk about aspects that we would rather like to prevent, such as reflection here right down under on the floor in a fitness center. I used to follow my aerobics lessons in that room, and you can imagine that trying to follow the lessons of the instructor is made difficult when you have every time this reflection in your eyes. So it's a very important part as well. Now then, view belongs to lighting quality, as does the selection of natural versus artificial lighting. Now, light we perceive through the eye. The light comes through the pupil into the eye and passes several jelly bodies, where most of the light is absorbed. The part that is not absorbed hits the retina, that's the inner layer of the eye. And in the retina, we have light-sensitive cells. The part where the most light-sensitive cells are situated is called the fovea, which you can see right there. And the part where no light-sensitive cells are situated at all is called the blind spot. Now, in this layer, this retina layer, we have these light-sensitive cells, and we have the rods and the cones. You probably heard of them in your biology lessons at high school. The rods for the intensity of light, and the cones for the colors. But recently, a third light receptor has been discovered. And this third light receptor doesn't help us to see, but receives light, amount of light, and helps us to control our day-night rhythm. How does this happen? Under influence of light, which is detected by this third light-sensitive sensor, the so-called melatonin hormone is produced, and this hormone makes us want to sleep. So if enough light is received through the eye during the day, at the end of the day, there's enough melatonin that wants us to go to sleep. Now, when we are awakened at night and we're exposed to light, this production of melatonin stops. And so does a lot of processes in your body that help you to recover the activities that you performed during the day. Now, some research has showed that this interruption of this is day-night rhythm by working at night, so by night shift workers, is not so good for your health. In fact, our Dutch Health Council defined that there are certain risks being a night worker. You have a higher risk for heart and vascular disease and diabetes type 2, and most likely night nurses also have a higher risk for getting breast cancer. Acoustical quality. Acoustical quality is influenced both by sounds, noise produced outdoors. Think of a passing car or an airplane coming over. And acoustical quality is influenced by noise created indoors. Quarreling neighbors, flushing of a toilet, all these kind of noises influence acoustical quality. But also vibrations are an important part. But you can imagine that noise protection and noise insulation are very important parameters in noise quality, in acoustical quality. Especially that we know how important a good night's sleep is, and I will tell you a bit more about that later, related to noise. The ear is the part of our body that receives sounds, noise. The sounds come into the ear through the external auditory channel and set the ossicles and the eardrum in motion. Now, these motions, these vibrations, they are passed on to the fluid in the inner ear, where we have the sound-sensitive cells. And they receive those and transfer those messages through the 8th cranial nerve into the brain, where they get interpreted. Now, we all know that if we have been to a concert with very loud music, you feel your ears sometimes still vibrating. If this noise has been very, very loud, your ossicles and eardrum have been vibrating so heavily that they might even get small ruptures or even bigger ruptures. And this is what's called hearing loss in the long run. But there's also another pathway of an effect that noise can have already on moderate levels of sound or noise. It can cause disturbance of activities, it can cause disturbance of sleep, and this anti-stress mechanism gives us annoyance. Now, what happens in our brain when you perceive this annoyance? You get stressed by an external stressor, like smell, or too warm, too cold, noise, a very important one, and in the brain, the adrenal glands produce adrenaline, and as a counter effect, noradrenaline is produced. This is just to make your body respond to this stressor. And you need these hormones, otherwise you would not even be able to function. But when this stressor takes a long time, other types of hormones are being produced. And if they take a very, very long time, you get a chronic production of the so-called anti-stress hormones. And they can finally lead to a chronic imbalance in hormones released. Now, one of these hormones is called cortisol. We know a lot of cortisol. A lot of research has been done, but mostly in the psychological area. But it seems that also these physical stressors can cause these hormones to be produced. Now, we know that high cortisol levels can contribute to changes in carbohydrate and fat metabolism, obesity, and can also lead to anxiety, depression, and heart disease, while low cortisol levels can lead to fatigue, allergies, asthma, and increased weight. Now, if you look carefully, these are the same diseases and disorders I mentioned in the beginning. So the last factor, air quality. Air quality is defined as the exposure to pollutants, several pollutants. We have gaseous pollutants, of some which you can smell. You see an example in the upper corner, left corner, of a mold that is growing there in a bathroom. This mold can emit smells, but also irritating pollutants. We also have gaseous pollutants we cannot smell that are still not good for our health. Think of carbon monoxide that is produced when we're cooking on gas. Then there are whole lots of other pollutants in that indoor air that can have an effect. We have water that can influence the growth, for example, of mold growth, or different biological particles. And then we have also a lot of other particles there in that indoor air. An example of a biological particle is in the middle, up. It's called the house dust mite. And this house dust mite, you can find in your bed. Everyone has them in their beds because they live from the female, from the human body skin, breasts. And their faces, some people are allergic to. About 10% of the population is allergic to this house dust mite, at least in the Netherlands. Then we have also particles that are produced by building materials. An example of that is asbestos fiber, which you see in the right corner below. And we all know the consequences of that one. Now, these pollutants come from several sources of pollution. Of course, from outdoor air, traffic, pollen, dirt, from people. But also from activities and products, such as smoking, cooking, cleaning, printing, a very important one, from different materials, construction and furnishing materials, like carpets, even bookshelves can produce pollutants. And then, not to forget, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system. Already some 20 years ago, a project run in the European Union called Airless, and there we investigated the different components of these HVAC systems. We found that most of these components can actually pollute the air instead of cleaning it when they are not well maintained, and especially the filters and the ductworks. And even humidifiers and rotating heat exchangers, the latter is used a lot to regain energy. Now, what is also important with sources of pollution is that they can interact when they're actually already in a building, in an indoor environment. We know chemicals can react, but also the pollution sources themselves. Here you see an example of a linoleum flooring material that is glued straight on a concrete floor. Now, I was called in this building because the occupants had problems with their health. They had skin rashes, they had severe breathing problems, and they had headaches, all kinds of sick building-like symptoms. Now, we discovered that this linoleum was glued on the wet concrete when the concrete was still wet, so this building was quite new. It was not even a few months old. And we know from this linoleum, the backing of the linoleum, can react with the compounds that come out of the concrete when it's drying out. And this creates certain alcohols and aldehydes that can create those symptoms that we saw with the people there in that building. So bad indoor air quality has been associated with lung cancer, with cardiovascular diseases, with chronic respiratory diseases, building-related illnesses, irritation of eyes and skin, odor, decrease in productivity and learning performance. Now, we perceive the air through our nose. We have two senses in our noses. We have the odor sense, the olfactory sense, with which we can perceive levels of pollutants at parts per trillion level, which is a lot better than most instruments we have available in the field studies we perform. And we have the common chemical sense, which is all over the line, the respiratory lining in the mouth and in the nose, you can find it, and we can perceive irritation with that. Now, when we breathe in the air through the nose or through the mouth, it passes a lot of tubes, where it eventually comes into our lung cells. They are called the alveoli. Before they reach it, a lot of particles are already taken out, but some of the particles can reach, especially the fine particles, can reach these lung cells, of which the ultra-fine particles can even pass the lung cells and get into our blood. And that happens during the exchange of gases of oxygen and carbon dioxide. So when we breathe in, we breathe out, we need oxygen, and we breathe out carbon dioxide. But with that, also the ultrafine particles can pass. Now we have about 30 million lung cells available with a total surface area of 85 square meter, which is quite a lot to make this exchange, this passage happen. Now, these ultrafine particles can reach our organs, even our brain, and they can also just stick into our lungs or in our eyes and cause their oxidative stress. Oxidative stress happens when there are more free radicals than antioxidants. And this is what these ultrafine particles have on them. They have lots of free radicals. And eventually, this can lead to even dying of cells. Somebody wants to get in, I guess. Now, oxidative stress doesn't only occur through air pollution, but it can also happen through light. UV light can burn our skin. That's also called oxidative stress. And when our ossicles and eardrum get ruptured, this is also called oxidative stress. So, we have a lot of stress mechanisms available to cope with these stressors I just talked about. And each of these stress mechanisms has relations with the diseases and disorders that we have identified. You see, it's not so easy to keep sticking to our single-dose response relation effects that we use for our standards. There's a lot happening in that human body, and it's almost impossible to relate it back. But then we also see interactions at environment level that make it us even more difficult. When sunlight heats up the interior surfaces, or thermal conditions and indoor air, we know that emissions of VOC increase when the temperature rises. Between acoustics and indoor air, by the introduction of ventilation air, by HVAC systems, the equipment noise as well as airflow noise, or when you open a window, you introduce the outdoor noise indoors. So it's not so easy. So what do we use these days to define health and comfort? We have several groups of indicators available. We have the dose or environmental parameter, concentrations of certain pollutants, ventilation rate, temperature, lighting intensity. They all belong to that group of indicators. We have the indicators that are focused on the occupant, such as sick leave, productivity, number of symptoms or complaints. And we have the indicators that are focused on the building and its occupants. Think of certain measures or characteristics of a building, such as the possibility for mold growth, an important one. And we even use labeling of systems and components. Now you see that the first group of indicators I colored red, because that's the group of indicators that we usually use in our standards and guidelines to help us create a good indoor environmental quality. But we also see that the mechanisms that are used to define these standards and values actually are not straightforward. Look at the ventilation rate that we have been trying to define now for almost 200 years now. It seems clear to me that we still have no clue what to do. We just try and see what happens. So even after more than 100 years of research and development in this area, it seems very difficult still to create really a good indoor environmental quality based on those standards and guidelines. There's an obvious discrepancy between those standards and end users' wishes and needs. And this could be due to a lack of knowledge. So what do we need? Now, first go back to our current view on indoor environmental quality. Our current view is based on effect modeling. We use single-dose response relationships in our standards. Now, except for health-threatening exposures, complexity, number of indoor environmental parameters, and lack of knowledge make a performance assessment using only those threshold levels for the single parameters difficult, and in some cases, even meaningless. And you saw the mechanisms in our human body. They are so complex. So we need a different view, at least, on indoor environmental quality. I'm not saying we should get rid of the standards and guidelines, but we need a different view where we look into scenarios and consider problems, interaction, and effects. We look into situations in those scenarios instead of single-dose response relationships only. That means that we are in need for other indicators. And, well, we have those three groups available, of which two of them we hardly use in our regulations, standards, and guidelines. We could use it a bit more often. We also need perhaps another research model where we include all these positive and negative stressors. Also positive stressors should be taken on board. And where we are aware of the interactions that take place over time, but also the interactions that take place through the preference and needs of the human person in that. And so we need to take into account that people are different. Now, in order to make this research model work and to see whether it is valid at all, we need a lot of lab and field studies to collect data. To collect data for each scenario, homes, offices, schools, cities perhaps, and even different situations in those scenarios. It also means that we need to use other assessment and analytical methods. We use basically linear regression, and we basically use measurements in the field, monitoring. It also means that we should be aware that all of these factors and possible stressors are important to consider when you assess. Now, in the past 7 years or so, 8 years, we have performed several field studies for different scenarios to get grip on this model, to see if it works. We started with office air in 2012, where we investigated 167 office buildings in 8 European countries, and we managed to use a checklist and a questionnaire and to define some patterns of stressors by using multivariate regression analysis. We repeated this trick, you could say, or this approach in homes in 2015 with 399 students. And then we repeated again in schools 2 years ago. We investigated 54 classrooms in the Netherlands and totally 1,145 children. And in that investigation, we not only looked for the negative stressors, but we also tried to find positive stressors and looking for preferences and needs. Now, I'm going to tell you a little bit about that last study. So this study was performed in 21 primary schools, and we investigated 2 situations in that school scenario. 17 schools had the traditional educational system, and 4 of those schools had a non-traditional educational system, which means they followed the theory of Dalton, Jena, or Montessori. So it's really a different way of teaching. We used a checklist to investigate the stressors in the classroom and in the building, 54 classrooms. And we used a questionnaire to get more information on the stressors, the effects, the preferences, and needs. We also submitted a questionnaire to the teachers to get more ideas about what do they do to improve indoor environmental quality in their classroom when a child complains about something. So to look at interactions with the indoor environmental quality. Now, we found with respect to the symptoms that they were not that serious, the symptoms, but what was interesting to see here that the boys had in general a higher percentage of symptoms than the girls, while the girls complained more about comfort. With comfort, what was very interesting to see is that in average, 87% of those children were bothered by noise. Noise created mainly by themselves. 63% was bothered by smells, also created by themselves. Think of farting, that was what they told us. So it's interesting here that those two aspects came out so clearly. Now, in the comparison between the traditional versus the non-traditional schools, we saw that on average, the children at the traditional schools had more complaints and more symptoms than at non-traditional schools. And because of this reason, this was statistically relevant, we performed the multivariate analysis to find the patterns of stressors that I discussed a little bit earlier, only for the traditional schools, because it was not statistical correct to use both situations over that time. Now, we performed that multivariate analysis, and we found relations between the number of health symptoms and the location of the school building, the heating system applied, and whether solar devices were hampering opening windows. But comfort, the number of comfort complaints, we found a relation between ventilation type, window frame color, which you see right in the right corner below. So when the window frame color was dark compared to the wall color, they complained more. Floor material and vacuum cleaning frequency were also found relevant. So this was, we tried to relate building-related indicators with occupant-related indicators. Now, that means that we took care of 2 parts of this research model, at least first steps were made there. We looked at 2 situations and we looked at patterns of stressors. But we also looked at the occupants, at their possible differences between their preferences and needs in order to define profiles of children. We performed a 2-step cluster analysis to see whether we could define profiles, and we used the complaints they had, the symptoms and diseases, and we used the important index for 10 indoor environmental factors, as is shown here. So this is the this shows that the important index of for hearing teacher well was given the highest mark, while fresh air was giving the second highest mark. And we used preferences for individual control devices, as you can see them here. Headphone was pointed out the most, and ventilator at a desk to create fresh air, but also to lower the temperature was rated the second highest. Now, with that information, we managed to define 6 profiles of children. As you can see here, one of those profiles, which was called All, they were bothered by everything, and they found everything important. While there was also a group named Nothing, they were hardly bothered by anything, and they found nothing important. So there is a big range there. And so they're really different. This is what this shows. So that was the third part. But we also looked at interactions by this questionnaire of teachers. We asked the teachers to point out, from a number of actions, how often they perform those actions during the week to improve indoor environmental quality. Now, what we found is that those actions that they performed did not result in less complaints. So we correlated this with the complaints of the children in those classrooms, which shows us that it is very difficult for the teacher to satisfy the children, because maybe they don't have enough means to do so. But it also shows that if you satisfy one child, it might cause problems for another. Looking at their profiles, this might not be a surprise. So we looked into stressors and effects, preference and needs, and environment interactions in 2017. Then we performed, as a follow-up, we performed a lab study to go deeper into the interactions at human level and to go more into the preferences and needs and the stressors and the effects. And we performed that study in the SenseLab. And I'm going to show you a movie of that. If it works. Yes.
Mijn naam is Philomena Bluizen en ik ben hoogleraar binnenmilieu bij de faculteit bouwkunde, afdeling Architectural Engineering and Technology. En ik doe hier, op deze plek, doe ik onderzoek met kinderen naar het binnenmilieu. Het SenseLab is eigenlijk een onderzoeksruimte, maar ook een onderwijsfaciliteit en een kennisoverdrachtsfaciliteit. Het is verdeeld in 2 delen. Waar we hier nu zitten, dat is het onderzoeksdeel. Dat is een ruimte waar we alles kunnen aanpassen wat betreft binnenmilieu. En het andere deel, dat bestaat uit 4 kamers, testkamers. Dat zijn eigenlijk koelcellen waar we elk van de 4 onderdelen van het binnenmilieu een testje mee doen. En daar kunnen kinderen, maar ook volwassenen, studenten, testjes doen met hun zintuigen.
De leukste vond ik eigenlijk die virtual reality. Het was wel heel erg... Een beetje gek dat je dan ineens in een andere ruimte zit. Dat is nou eenmaal bij virtual reality.
Ja, ik zat dus naast iemand anders en ik keek zo om me heen en het was in een klaslokaal. En er zat niemand, dus ik ging zo voelen daar. En toen voelde ik, dacht ik, er zit daar niemand. Dat was wel grappig.
We hebben gekeken naar verschillende soorten lichten en hoe je het in een klaslokaal vond. En dat was wel heel leuk.
Nou, dat je gewoon de hele tijd kon ruiken en allemaal geuren die je dan moest raden. En dat vond ik wel heel leuk.
Het eerste doel is echt onderzoek doen. maar met gebruik van de eindgebruiker van gebouwen. In dit geval de afgelopen weken de scholieren op de lagere scholen, de groepen 6, 7, 8. En aan de andere kant kennisoverdracht. Dat is heel belangrijk. Ik heb gezien dat er heel weinig op dit gebied bekend is bij mensen, binnen milieugebied.
Nou, we zitten met 33 in de klas en we zitten niet in een heel groot lokaal. Dus dan wordt het soms in de zomer wel eens benauwd en heel druk.
Toen hebben we een soort van U-vorm bedacht en dan zit de juf in het midden met haar instructietafel. En dan past het allemaal wat beter. En ook dat we één hoge kast hebben en niet meerdere kleine kasten, want dat neemt ook meer ruimte in.
Een hele mooie robot die op zijn buik een airco heeft en die kussens heeft, zodat op alle tafels kussens liggen, zodat je ook niet meer met je pen zo kan tikken de hele tijd.
Hoe je je eigen binnenmilieu moet regelen, dat weet men eigenlijk niet. Nou, dat wordt eigenlijk geprobeerd in die vier testkamers om mensen met hun eigen zintuigen in aanraking te brengen en te laten zien wat je kan doen in een gebouw of in een woonomgeving.
Okay, what you saw in the movie was the sense lab with four test chambers. As you can see here in the schematic drawing, one for air quality, one for thermal quality, one for light and one for sound quality, and it looks like this when you stand in front of it. Then the real research room is the experience room, which is made for integrated perception of indoor environmental quality. Now in that room we can change almost anything. We can change the materials we use there for the floor, for the ceiling, for the walls. We have three different lighting systems available. We can produce noise and we can change the air conditioning system, even the type of air conditioning we use. This is how it looks like the inside. We have two types of ventilation system. We have displacement ventilation from floor to ceiling by a perforated plinth just above the floor, and on the side of the ceiling it is exhausted. And we have mixing ventilation from ceiling to floor, air supply in the plenum with four ceiling grills, and exhaust again in the perforated plinth on the short side of the experience room. Now, this sense lab was created by the TU Delft, but in cooperation and sponsorship with 25 companies, which I like to show you here. Thank them again for their contribution. So the SenseLab studies, that was the first study actually performed in this SenseLab. SenseLab was opened at the end of 2016, but it still took more than a year to get it really work. This is quite normal, I think, in laboratories. We invited 335 children from seven primary schools, and they visited the SenseLab on 10 different days. They were divided in three groups of maximal 16 children. The first group was started in the experience room, where they performed an assessment tests and they performed a workshop. And the second group went first to the four test chambers, where they each were divided over the test chambers, where they performed different tests, which I will not show you today. And the third group, the SenseLab, is located in the Science Center in Delft. Science Center is a museum where you can see what kind of technological developments have been created by the Technical University in Delft. But you can also actually participate in those scientific developments, which is quite good. Now, in the experience room, as I said, we did two types of tests. We did assessments, and in total, we assessed 36 combinations of different room characteristics. So we had all or less acoustical panels. We used two ventilation principles, three types of lighting, and three types of background sound. Now, each of these groups of children was exposed to two of those combinations. What we found was that less acoustical panels had a clear influence on children's evaluation of sound, smell, draft, and light. So a lot of interaction took place there. And talking children affected the assessment of both sound and smell while we didn't do anything with smell. We didn't change any smelly things. So we think some kind of precondition is taking place in the children's mind, thinking of the situation at schools where they were bothered by sound and smell created by themselves that much. But this needs to be validated, of course. Now, in the workshop that we performed also in the experience room, we asked them, first of all, what is your biggest problem in your own classroom? And they could draw that and write that down and present it afterwards. And in part two of the workshop, we asked them to find a solution for that biggest problem they had. Now, they came with all kinds of solutions. Some created a multi-solution, like the ideal human habitat creation, as this person called it. I translated it for you. But also, some of them really focused on one problem, like a gas mask against smell, or a headphone for noise, which was obvious. And then there also were solutions that had nothing to do with indoor environmental quality. This child drew a drawing where he was sitting at home on a sofa while there was a robot teacher in the classroom. Amazing. We had many of those, actually. So, working at home. Maybe this is what they see their parents do, so they might want that also. So what did we find in these lab studies? We found interaction effects of different IQ factors seem to take place at human level, but it needs to be investigated more. Children were very able to provide problems and solutions for IQ problems. So it's definitely good to use the occupants of the building to see what we can do for them. For each IQ aspect, preferences and needs were tested in those test chambers in relation to different environmental conclusions. Now, what can we conclude? We can definitely conclude after the first part of my presentation that there is a need for understanding the indoor environment and its occupants. And we need to acknowledge the fact that this indoor environment is more than the sum of its parts and that it can change over time. We also need to acknowledge that people are different and that their needs and preferences can also change over time. Makes it even more complex. So then I introduced this integrated analysis approach, which I tried to show you that we are trying to prove that we could use this eventually. We look into patterns of stressors. We look at different interactions at environment and human level. And we consider profiles and preferences and needs for different scenarios and different situations in those scenarios. And eventually, I hope that by doing lots of lab and field studies, we will be able to match profiles of people with patterns of positive and negative stressors for a certain situation in a certain scenario. That will be the ideal. Well, now, first steps have been made, I think, and many of us are waiting for the next ones. We are very eager, but they are ahead of us awaiting to be taken. Well, thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Blyson. I realize we're running a couple minutes behind. We're going to begin the second keynote in about 5 minutes. So let's take a few questions. And then if you do have further questions afterwards, we can speak at the coffee break.
Yeah.
So are there any questions from the audience? Yeah.
You showed when you described the types of classrooms, the traditional classroom, my experience in New Zealand, sorry, Michael Don from New Zealand, but is that the traditional classroom in a primary school is now has no desks. There are a range of small desks, but there's not one desk and one chair for every primary school student. Is that a traditional classroom in the Netherlands, or is it still one child, one desk?
Yes, still that.
Very interesting.
But also at the non-traditional schools.
Right. I'm saying that the conventional classroom now is being pushed to being 90 children, one room, three teachers, and not one child per desk.
Okay.
I'd like to talk more about that, but I just wanted to clarify that.
Thank you. Interesting. Yeah.
Thank you. So the non-traditional classrooms also have desks, just to clarify.
Yes, they also have desks. They only have a different teaching method. So they are not staying all the time in the same classroom, and I think this is might be the reason.
Okay, interesting.
For the difference.
My name is Henk Kranenberg. I have a question about the research program. Now it's focusing on children, especially the age of children at primary school. But I can imagine it's also very interesting to do such study for adults in a working environment, or you can imagine, or back home, so there are different environments you can study. Is there a plan to start up such a program, or is this already done?
Actually, I have submitted a proposal to NWO, that's our Dutch research organization, that could fund that on offices. So, yes, we are planning to do so. We can also furnish the experience room as an office chamber, office room, so easily.
First, sorry, my bad English. But I'm Kátia, I'm from Brazil, and we study the same things, but in hospital, but in any money, with any money. It's very difficult to study this with any money or any space for study. And we study our hospitals or about healthy environments, healthcare, and your study.
Yeah, I have a PhD student, Annemarie Eikelenboom. She has just finished a field study in 6 hospitals in the Netherlands, and she's doing the same now to try to do the multivariate analysis, to the profiling, etc. Yes. Yeah, so if you come later, I can give you her contact.
Yeah, grazie.
Okay.
Thanks. Yeah, I think I'll just take one more question right here.
Rajat Gupta, Oxford Brookes University in the UK. Thank you for a fascinating presentation. My question really is, all the learning that you've had through the Sense Lab, especially the interventions, have you been able to transfer those to real classrooms to really see what is the influence of making that change on the learning behaviors of the pupils? Not in the lab, but in the real world. And the reason I'm asking this is, so we've been doing a study on productivity in the UK. We've been trying to do interventions in offices. Yeah. I know how challenging that can be.
No, not yet. The last analysis were made last month on this study in the Sense Lab. But the next steps are indeed to go back again to the schools, to the field, and try to intervene there. I have another PhD student who's working on an individual control device for the acoustics. So she made a kind of an umbrella above each table, and she wants to place that in the field, in classroom. So we are about to do these kind of things. Yes.
Wonderful. Thank you. And thank you for all the great questions. If you can all just put your hands together and give a really warm thank you for Dr. Gleason. That would be wonderful. Thank you so much.
Filomena, we have a little present for Maria.